So now we see how to build a whole router. We saw how to really offload the CPU so it wouldn't have to do that much, and it would allow all kinds of accelerators to do the rest of the job. Let's move on to discuss memory. Our SoC looks like this. Our router looks like this. So we have our CPU that we said is our host, and it's supposed to not do that much. It has its interconnect bus, which has to be high speed enough to pass, you know, the Ethernet high speed transmissions through the bus to wherever we want. And we have, you know, our DMA, which is taking care of our memory accesses. Maybe the DMA is part of the Ethernet. We have all kinds of ASICs, you know, light processors, accelerators that are offloading the CPU. And we have our on-chip memory here, which is storing things. But really, what about memory? I mean, we have all these things. We can communicate with the peripherals, with an off-chip network, etc. But a router needs a lot more of memory. It needs to buffer packets. It needs to store routing tables. It needs to host the operating system. A lot of things that will not fit on our on-chip memory. Our on-chip memory is at the maximum, you know, several megabytes, maybe on really chips that are dominated by memory and they're very huge. It can have, you know, maybe 100 megabytes, maybe a little more than that. But that's really nowhere near enough. We need to use DRAM. So what is DRAM? Taking a look at, you know, Onur-Mutlu's type of graphs over here, we have this pyramid which shows the organization of DRAM that starts at the bottom, like the smallest kind of quanta that you will access in a DRAM, which starts at the row and column, goes up through bank, chip, rank, DIMM, and channel. So let's discuss what these things are. We'll start with the channel. And really, the channel is an actual bus that goes from the main chip that's talking to the DRAM to the actual DRAM modules, something like a 64-byte DRAM module. And usually our processors will have something like two separate channels so they can talk to two DRAM chips with full bandwidth separately. But some like GPUs and so forth may have like four channels or something like that. Each of these channels, we have one or more of these DIMMs connected to it. So these DIMMs, or dual inline memory modules, are this board over here, which we see has eight chips on it. It can have more than that, but usually eight chips. And it can have eight chips on both sides. The different generations of DRAM also have this little notch in different places, so we won't accidentally connect the wrong type of DRAM module to the same slot on the board. But in general, they're all on these DIMMs like this. And again, the DIMM can have two sides to it, so it can have either eight chips or 16 chips. And each of those eight chips is what we call a rank. So that's the next hierarchy over here. And a rank is a single unit that writes out, you know, that can transmit 64 bits of data to the processor at a very high speed. These 64 bits of data, they're actually made out of eight separate bytes, which come from eight chips. So the next real level of hierarchy is this chip we have over here. And each of these chips that we see here, it provides one byte to the output. But on the chips, we also have a suborganization called banks. So we'll usually have eight banks on the chip. Each of these banks is passing over a byte to the multiplexer at the output of the chip, and the chip is only selecting one of the outputs of each of these banks at all times to provide that byte, which will go and become the 64 bytes that goes out from the DIMM to our main processor, our main chip. Inside each of these banks, we have the kind of lowest hierarchy that we can discuss, which are the arrays. And the arrays, or the rows and the columns, they're going to be the actual like DRAM cells, which we can read one byte out of to the multiplexer of the bank and put out a byte. The interesting thing about this is, at least at a virtual type of high level, we have, you know, a lot of bits over here. They'll probably be divided into several subarrays, which we don't actually discuss the suborganization inside. But at the bottom, they'll have this row buffer that will store a whole row of the bits that is inside one of these banks. And how we access this type of a chip is we have two signals called RAS and CAS, which are the row access select and the column access select. And what we do is we first put the row address, we tell from the CPU or from the whatever our host is that's talking to them, we say we want a certain row. That row will go through all this whole hierarchy and get in the end to the bank over here and select a certain row in the selected bank, and it will activate that row and bring it out to the output, or actually into the row buffer. And then we use the column address, which will select the particular byte we want from this row to then push out and get back into our chip. And that we select with this column access select. So it's a kind of a two operation type of an access, where we'll see in a second that these things can take a lot longer. Like a row address can take a lot of time until we actually get the row into the row buffer, and then we can use the column address to go and select the data. So let's see how this organization works inside. So we have, let's say, a DIMM that has 1 gigabyte of memory. So we have 8 chips. Each one has 1 gigabit. What is the organization of one of these chips? Well, maybe it's something like 128,000 rows by 8,000 rows. That will give us a 1 gigabit chip of DRAM. And we said that inside the this gigabit of memory, which is one chip, we're probably going to divide it, because that's a lot of rows to have 128,000 rows. So we'll break it into, say, 8 banks, which each have 16,000 rows. So each of these guys will be a bank. And as we mentioned before, we have a row buffer at the bottom of each bank. So all of these 8K rows will be accessed at one time and read out to the bottom of the row. As we see, we select one row over here, we read it out, and we store it in the sense amplifiers that are at the bottom. They latch the data from the row. And what that means is we can select a different row from each bank, store it in the row buffer, and it's kind of a cache for this bank. So we don't have to go, as long as we keep on reading out different bytes from inside the row that's stored in the row buffer, we don't have to go and select a different row. We call this selection of a row, we call it activation. So that's to activate a row in a certain bank. And again, this bank can select one row, can activate one row, and this bank can select another row. So we will have different rows that are cached in the row buffer of each bank. But then once they're cached in here, we can go and select with the cache any of the bytes that are in the buffer. And that will use this this cache type of a signal to do, and we get the column address, and then we can actually do bursts, because we could read out, you know, each of these bytes in sequence to get them out. And that's much faster than going and activating another row. Another thing is we can write to these. So the writes will actually be done to this latch over here, and therefore the data that's inside the array is dirty. And so what we're going to have to do is, once we decide to change and get another row, activate a different row from inside the array, we're going to have to actually write back the data. And that's what we call a pre-charge. So we do a pre-charge operation. It's going to write back the data, and then we can change the row that's selected and read it out. And that takes quite a long time. So the row address selection is going to take quite a long time. And then we can go and change the byte that we read out of the column, you know, one after the other, in type of a burst. In other words, it's much cheaper to go and read out many, many different pieces of data that are already stored in the row buffer than go and keep on changing the row that we want to access each time. So let's take one of these situations where we have, you know, our different banks, and we've selected this row inside this bank, and we've selected this row inside this bank, and we start accessing the DRAM. So we start with bank 0, row 0, so we activate this row, and then we do bank 1, row 1, and we activate this row. And our subsequent accesses to the different bytes are, again, going to be in bank 0, row 0, and bank 1, row 1, and we keep hitting inside the row buffer. But then we go and we have to access bank 0, row 3, and that means that the data is not stored inside this row buffer. We have to go, we have to pre-charge and write back whatever was there, and then go and select a different row and write it out to the, and latch it inside the row buffer over here. And you see that on the next access, we again went to one of the bytes that's in bank 0, row 0, which we had before, but now it's already row 3 that's stored in over here, so we have to pre-charge again, write back row 3, and read out row 0. We continue, we access bank 1, row 2, and we had bank 1, row 1 over there, so now we're accessing row 2, so we again have to pre-charge what's in here and activate a different row till we have row 2 over here. And now we're going to access bank 1, row 1, and again, we wanted row 1, but row 2 is stored in our buffer, so we're going to have to pre-charge again, write back row 1, and store, write back row 2, and read out row 1. So that was kind of messy, but look, it would be kind of easy if we could just reorder these accesses. So let's take this access over here to bank 0, row 0, and switch places with the access to bank 0, row 3. So then when we would get to this access, we would still have bank zero, row zero stored inside this row buffer, and we wouldn't have to make a precharge, and we'll move the access to bank zero, row three later. And again, the same type of thing, we could move this access to bank one, row one earlier, so bank one, row one was already precharged and stored inside here. We would access it before we actually went and had to change which row was stored in our row buffer. So since we see that this type of memory reorganization of the actual transactions can really improve our whole throughput because we won't have to keep on changing rows, then what we can do is have a controller, and this is what we do. We put a DDR controller that's going to optimize the access, the memory access pattern. So this is one of the kind of complex pieces that we're going to put on our chip that's going to communicate with the DDR, with the dual data rate DRAM, and optimize this type of action. So we'll have the best type of organization of the operations to access the DRAM banks.